Hi everyone, my name is Pauline. As a nuclear medicine resident, I see a lot of people with thyroid diseases. This is why I made a series of videos in which I explain everything related to the thyroid, from physiology to pathology to some important diagnostic tools. You can choose to watch them all, or you can go to the playlist and watch the videos that seem interesting to you. This is the first in a series of 4 teaching videos about the thyroid gland. In this video, we will do a quick recap of the thyroid physiology. Thyroid hormone release is controlled by the hypothalamic-pituitary-thyroid axis. Thyrotrophin-releasing hormone is secreted from the hypothalamus. It reaches the anterior pituitary, and here it causes the release of thyroid-stimulating hormone. TSH is transported in the blood and acts upon the thyroid gland, promoting the release of thyroid hormone. The thyroid produces 2 hormones, T3 and T4. Both TSH and TRH are regulated in a negative feedback loop by circulating T4 and T3. Although T3 is more biologically active than its counterpart T4, the secreted thyroid hormone is 90% T4. Most of the T4 will later be converted to T3. More than 99% of T4 and T3 in the circulation are bound to the proteins albumin and thyroxine-binding globulin. But only the free or unbound fraction of T3 and T4, which is less than 1%, is able to have a biological effect. The thyroid hormones are produced in the colloid of the thyroid when iodine attaches to a glycoprotein called thyroglobulin. Let's look at this process in a bit more detail. Iodine ions are actively transported across their cell membrane from the bloodstream into the cytosol. As a result, the concentration of iodide ions trapped in the follicular cells is many times higher than the concentration in the bloodstream. Iodide ions then undergo oxidation. This means that their negatively charged electrons are removed. The peroxidase enzymes then link the iodine to the tyrosine amino acids in thyroglobulin to produce 2 intermediaries, a tyrosine attached to 1 iodine and a tyrosine attached to 2 iodines. When one of each of these intermediaries is linked by covalent bonds, the resulting compound is T3, a thyroid hormone with 3 iodines. Much more commonly, 2 copies of the second intermediary bond, forming T4, a thyroid hormone with 4 iodines. These hormones remain in the colloid center of the thyroid follicles until TSH stimulates endocytosis of the hormones back into the follicle cells. There, enzymes break apart the thyroglobulin, releasing free T3 and T4. T3 and T4 then diffuse across the cell membrane and enter the bloodstream. The thyroid hormones are often referred to as metabolic hormones because their levels influence our basal metabolic rate. This is the amount of energy used by the body at rest. When T3 and T4 bind to the mitochondria, they cause an increase in ATP production. In addition, T3 and T4 initiate the transcription of genes involved in glucose oxidation. These mechanisms prompt cells to produce more ATP, which causes an increase in heat production. This so-called calorigenic effect raises the body temperature. Adequate levels of thyroid hormones are also required for protein synthesis and for fetal development and growth. They are especially critical for normal development of the nervous system, and they continue to support neurological function in adults. The thyroid hormones have a complex relationship with reproductive hormones, and deficiencies can influence libido, fertility, and other aspects of reproductive function. Finally, thyroid hormones increase the body's sensitivity to catecholamines by upregulation of receptors in the blood vessels. When levels of T3 and T4 are excessive, this effect accelerates the heart rate, strengthens the heart contractility, and increases the blood pressure. Because thyroid hormones regulate metabolism, heat production, protein synthesis, and many other body functions, thyroid disorders can have severe and widespread consequences. What these consequences are will be discussed in the next two videos. Do you know why people take iodine pills after a nuclear accident? When there's an explosion at a nuclear power plant, radioactive iodine is one of the first substances that's released into the atmosphere. The thyroid absorbs available iodine from the bloodstream. It cannot distinguish between stable, regular iodine and radioactive iodine and will absorb whatever it can. However, the thyroid can become saturated with iodine, and when that happens, it can't store any more. So the theory is that if you take enough good iodine, so iodine pills, there will be no room left in the thyroid for any bad or radioactive iodine. That radioactive iodine should then simply pass through the body and get excreted via the kidneys. This is why taking iodine pills can help protect you from radioactive iodine. Let's quickly summarize what we've just learned. The function of the thyroid gland is to take iodine, found in many foods, and convert it into thyroid hormones T4 and T3. Thyroid cells are the only cells in the body which can absorb iodine. These cells combine iodine and the amino acid tyrosine to make T3 and T4. T3 and T4 are then released into the bloodstream and they are transported throughout the body where they control your metabolism. Thyroid hormones are like heat. When the heat gets back to the thermostat, it turns the thermostat off. As the room cools or the thyroid hormone levels drop, the thermostat turns back on, TSH increases, and the furnace produces more heat or thyroid hormones. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you want to see more of my videos where I explain various medical topics in an easy and understandable way, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell button if you want to get notified every time I upload a video. In the next videos, we'll go deeper into what happens if the thyroid gland produces too much or too little hormones.